Hello, this is Zahirul. Welcome you on Frankly Speaking. My guest today is Mr. Hamid Mir. He is a Pakistani journalist, news anchor, and security analyst now visiting Bangladesh. He currently hosts the political talk show titled Capital Talk on Jio Television, in which top Pakistani politicians from the government and opposition have appeared. He's also writing a biography of Osama bin Laden, as well as a weekly column in Daily Jang, and also writes columns in Urdu newspapers in Pakistan. He was twice banned from Pakistani television by the Parvez Musharraf government in 2007 and by the Zardari government administration in June 2008. He has also received the Hilali Imtiaz, Pakistan's second highest civil award. We welcome Mr. Hamid Mir on my show, Frankly Speaking. Welcome.
Thank you, Zahir.
Thank you so much for being tonight with me. And I just mentioned that you have received Hilali Imtiaz, Pakistan's second highest civilian award. But I also know that your father, Mr. Waris Mir, he was also awarded Friends of Bangladesh Award in 2013 for his outstanding contribution during the War of Liberation of Bangladesh. So how did you feel when your father was awarded that Friends of Bangladesh Award, and you were also awarded Pakistan's second highest civil award?
Yeah, you see, last year the government of Pakistan announced Hilali Imtiaz for me, and I received an invitation from the president of Pakistan that I should come on the 23rd of March and receive my Hilali Imtiaz. At the same time, I was informed by the Bangladeshi government that they have decided to give award to some Pakistani writers and intellectuals who opposed the military operation in 1971. And they said that Bangladeshi government have decided to give that award, Friends of Bangladesh Award, to famous poet Faiz Ahmed Faiz, Habib Jalib, and my father Waris Mir, and some other people.
Okay.
And they said you come on 24th of March.
Okay. So it was a dilemma.
Yeah, it was a coincidence. So I was in a big fix. What should I do?
Yeah.
And the daughter of our great poet, Habib Jalab, she contacted me and she said that the Bangladesh High Commission called and they said that you come to Bangladesh to receive award on behalf of your father. So what should I do? I said, you go. She said, I cannot go. You go with me, because they have also informed me that we have given award for father of Hamid Mir.
Oh.
Then Asma Jahangir called me.
Okay.
Are you going there? I said, I have not decided yet. She said, you have to go. Otherwise, we will not go.
Oh.
I said, why? She said, because extremist people in Pakistan, they will start character assassination campaign against us. So you are the most well-known people, so you should act as a cover for us.
Okay. What does it mean?
So I said, cover for us, yet that we are weak people and they will start a campaign against us, so you face the music.
Okay.
So I said, okay, I will go. So then I sent my wife to receive my Hilali Imtiaz in Pakistan, and I came to Bangladesh. And I received my award, the daughter of Faiz Ahmed Faiz, the daughter of Habib Jalib, and the daughter of Malik Ghulam Jilani, Asma Jahangir, they also received the award. And by giving these award to famous Pakistani poets and writers, the government of Bangladesh proved that they are not enemies of the people of Pakistan. Yes, they have some differences with the government policies, but they like all those people in Pakistan who believe in democracy and who believe in true friendship with Bangladesh.
Okay. But Hamid, you have been a staunch advocate of building friendship between Pakistan and Bangladesh, and you're also asking the Pakistani governments time and again to issue official apology for the role and the atrocities committed during the War of Liberation in 1971. So what is your position right now?
I always support good friendly relations between Pakistan and Bangladesh, because I think that the people of Bangladesh, they are our brothers, and they are great people, because actually they created Pakistan. The political party which created Pakistan, its name was All India Muslim League. It was not created in Lahore or Karachi. It was created here in Dhaka,
in
1906. And the first Muslim League government was not established in Punjab or Sindh or in Balochistan.
Mm-hmm.
It was established in Bengal. And A.K. Fazle Haq was its prime minister. It was a coalition government of Muslim League and his party. Then Mr. Hussain Shahid Sohrawardi.
Yes.
He became the prime minister of United Bengal. And he was the one who motivated thousands of young educated Bengali youth to join the Pakistan movement. And Sheikh Mujibur Rahman was one of them.
Yeah.
If you read the memoirs of Sheikh Mujibur Rahman, he clearly said,
yes,
that he was actually idolizing Mr. Hussain Shahid Sohrawardi. So I think that the Pakistan movement was started by the Bengalis, and they were more active in the Pakistan movement, and they were the majority. But unfortunately, there was a martial law in Pakistan in 1958, and General Ayub Khan, he arrested Mr. Hussain Shahid Sohrawardi. And recently I discovered a letter written by Hussain Shahid Sohrawardi from Karachi jail to the then President General Ayub Khan. And there were tears in my eyes when I was reading that letter of Hussain Shahid Sohrawardi. And in that letter, Hussain Shahid Sohrawardi said that you have arrested me under the charges of treason. You think I am a traitor? I created Pakistan. That is my crime. That's why you think that I am a traitor. So as a student of history and politics,
yeah,
I think that now it's Bangladesh, but actually the people of Bangladesh created Pakistan. So that's why we cannot deny the facts of history. So that's why I think that we, the people who live in Pakistan, we should always respect the people of Bangladesh. They were the majority, we were the minority. But unfortunately, our military dictators,
yeah,
they violated the political rights of the Bengali brothers and sisters. And unfortunately, there was a military operation started in 1971. And I still remember, I was a very little boy. I was a school student in 1971. And my father and my mother, they used to cry when they came to know about this military operation.
Yes.
So they cried because they loved Pakistan.
Okay.
And I want good relations with the people of, between people of Bangladesh and Pakistan, because I love Pakistan. And if the people of Pakistan and if the government of Pakistan will say a sorry to the people of Bangladesh, it will not weaken Pakistan. It will give a new strength.
Rather, yeah.
It will give a new strength to Pakistan. And technically speaking, the government of Pakistan, Bangladesh and India, they signed a treaty in 1974. And according to that agreement, the government of Pakistan is bound to say sorry to the people of Bangladesh, and the government of Bangladesh is bound to forgive the people of Pakistan.
Okay, time to take a short break. Hamid Mir will be back right after the commercial. Dear viewers, we're taking a short break. We'll be back right after the commercial. My guest today is Mr. Hamid Mir, veteran journalist of Pakistan. Dear viewers, welcome back. You're watching Frankly Speaking. My guest today is Mr. Hamid Mir, Pakistani journalist. Hamid Mir, you know, you are aware about the trials, international crime tribunals, and there have been some verdict has already been given by the tribunals. Some cases has been disposed of by the Supreme Court Appellate Division. So do you think the trials against the persons who was charged for the collaborations with the then rulers of Pakistan for committing crime against humanity may jeopardize the relations between Pakistan and Bangladesh? You know that Pakistani foreign ministry has issued a statement and they said it is an internal matter, but there are some political rhetoric in all Pakistan. So how do you see this thing? Would it impact the relations between the two countries?
First of all, I must say that this is an internal matter of Bangladesh. And I share the view of our foreign ministry that Pakistanis should not
intervene
in the internal affairs of Bangladesh. Yes, there are some politicians in Pakistan who raised some objections. I remember the head of the Jamaat-Islami in Pakistan, Mr. Sirajul Haq. He was addressing a press conference while sitting with Mr. Imran Khan. And he was speaking against this verdict. But after completing his statement, he looked towards Imran Khan and he was expecting that Imran Khan should also speak on the same issue. But Imran Khan
kept mum.
No, he changed the subject and he started speaking on some other issue.
Okay.
And I remember 3-4 years back, I interviewed Imran Khan in my talk show.
Capital Talk.
And Imran Khan told me that he was very unhappy in 1971 when this military operation was going on.
Yeah.
And Imran Khan told me that he wanted that the government of Pakistan should apologize to the people of Bangladesh.
Okay.
So Imran Khan never spoke on this war crimes tribunal issue.
But there is saying that last year he changed his position a little bit after the verdict of Mr. Qadir Mullah.
You see, he is the coalition partner of Jamaat-Islami.
Oh, there is Saidi.
He is the coalition partner of Jamaat-Islami in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa province.
Oh, okay.
And Jamaat-Islami is putting pressure on many political parties. But you must note one thing. And I would like that all your viewers in Bangladesh should note down one thing. The Prime Minister of Pakistan, the Foreign Office in Pakistan, the main opposition party, Pakistan People's Party, then the biggest religious party, Jamiat Ulama Islam. Jamaat Islami is not the biggest
party,
religious
yeah,
party. Jamiat Ulama Islam is the biggest religious party headed by Maulana Fazlur Rahman.
Mm-hmm.
Awami National Party headed by Asfandiar Wali Khan. Muthada Qaumi Movement led by Mr. Altaf Hussain. These are the six major political parties in Pakistan. None of these parties commented on this issue of the war crimes in Bangladesh. So I think that this is an internal affair of Bangladesh and law of the land taken its own course. And if someone in Pakistan is not happy on this issue, the government of Bangladesh and the people of Bangladesh should not think that every Pakistani is interfering in Bangladesh. This is not a big issue in Pakistan.
This is not a big issue, and not the majority.
And I would like to say that, yes, our Home Minister Chaudhry Nisar Ali Khan did issue a statement.
Yeah.
But that was his personal view. The official policy on this issue was stated by our Foreign Office, and that was that we will not interfere in Bangladesh.
And that will prevail officially. Let's talk about something about your professional career. We know that your life had been endangered on several occasions in 2012 and this year also in April, I think, there was an attack on you and you survived by the grace of Almighty. So why your life have been threatened time and again?
You see, I am in this field of journalism from last 26 years. And many times I came under a lot of threats. I remember that I was arrested by Taliban in 1998 in Afghanistan. Mm-hmm. Again, I was arrested by Taliban after 9/11 when I visited Afghanistan to interview Osama bin Laden in 2001. Okay. I was arrested again. Then I was covering Israel-Lebanon war in 2006, and I was arrested in Lebanon.
In Lebanon.
Then I was in Palestine in 2011, and the Israeli forces, they started firing on me, so I survived. Then in, you see, 2012 was very serious assassination attempt. When the Taliban attacked the little girl Malala Yousafzai, who is campaigning for the girls' rights of education, and the Taliban attacked Malala Yousafzai in Swat area of Pakistan, and then they accepted the responsibility. And nobody in the media was ready to confront Taliban openly. So I decided to come out openly against Taliban. And I challenged them. I said, you are not Muslims. You are not human beings. And you are worse than animals. You have attacked a 15 years old girl, and she's like my daughter. And you have attacked my daughter, and I am your enemy.
Okay.
So after that show, I received a long 6-page letter from the spokesman of the Taliban, and he threatened me, and he said that we declare you
enemy of Taliban. Huh?
No, enemy of Islam.
Okay, enemy of Islam.
And it's very difficult for me to repeat the words they used for the little girl. They said she's a prostitute.
Oh.
So I was again, you see, I felt that maybe they are abusing my daughter.
Oh, okay.
So I showed their letter to my audience in my talk show, and I said, this is their mentality.
Oh.
They are saying that this 15-year-old little girl who is injured, they are saying that she is a prostitute.
Oh.
And I appealed to the people of Pakistan that you must recognize the brutal face of Taliban, and this letter is their brutal face. So after a few days, they planted a bomb under my car. But luckily, my driver saw the bomb, and we called the bomb disposal squad, and they defused the bomb.
Oh,
so
wow.
So I faced this threat because I challenged Taliban. And then you see what happened, that in
Karachi
2014. I was attacked in Karachi. I got 6 bullets. I was critically injured. I received bullet wounds from my shoulder, my stomach, legs, lower back. So,
how many bullets? 3, 4?
No, the 6 bullets.
6 bullets.
The 2 bullets are still in my body. I am carrying.
Really?
Carrying 2 bullets in my body. And luckily I was transferred to the hospital in time, and they operated. My bladder was punctured.
Okay.
My kidney was also affected.
Okay.
But with the grace of Almighty Allah, I survived. I informed my management before that attack that some.
Oh, you were visiting G office in Karachi.
Yeah, I gone there for an assignment. And few days before that attack, I informed my management that some people in the security establishment, they may attack me because of my position against the human rights violations in Balochistan.
Okay.
And
so that was not orchestrated by by the Taliban.
The first attack was by the Taliban. The second attack was by some people within the intelligence agencies.
Okay.
So then my TV channel took a stand because they also had some information that some people within the intelligence agencies were after my life. So then we paid the price, and that GOTV was shut down for many days. But we survived.
Okay.
The good journalism survived.
Will prevail.
Yeah.
Will survive. Okay. But time to take another short break. Dear viewers, we're having conversation with Mr. Hamid Mir, Pakistani journalist. We're taking another short break. We'll be back right after the commercial. Stay with us. KBS, welcome back. You're watching Frankly Speaking. My guest today, Mr. Hamid Mir, executive editor of Geo News. He's from Pakistan. Mr. Hamid Mir, just shed some light on the internal politics of Pakistan. We have been, following the Pakistani politics very interesting, and recently Imran Khan waging movement against the current regime of Nawaz Sharif. So, what's your apprehension? What is going on, and what is coming up in the next days ahead?
Zahir bhai, you know, the democracy in Pakistan is facing many challenges. This is first time in the history of Pakistan that a democratically elected government decided to try a former military dictator under the charges of treason. Former President General retired Pervez Musharraf is facing treason trial in Pakistan. This is first time in Pakistan. That's why a section of the people who think that they are very powerful and they are the only patriots in Pakistan, they are very angry with the Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif. I have lot of reservations on the policies of Nawaz Sharif, but despite my all reservations and differences, he is an elected Prime Minister.
Yes.
And the results of the 2013 elections were accepted by all the big political parties,
including PPP,
including Imran Khan.
Yes, yeah.
And Imran Khan got majority in one province, and he established his coalition government with the help of Jamaat-e-Islami in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa.
Yes.
But when Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif started the trial of General Pervez Musharraf, some people started hatching conspiracies against his government. And one day Imran Khan announced that he is going to start a long march, and
yes,
he will overthrow the government of Nawaz Sharif. And he announced that the D-Day is 14th of August, which is the Independence Day of Pakistan.
Okay.
And he claimed in the public meeting that when I will reach to Islamabad on 14th of August, the empire will raise his finger and Nawaz Sharif will be clean bowled. So I raised the question in my talk show, who is this empire? Which empire is planning to raise his finger? And who gave the authority of that empire to raise the finger? So this is not a cricket ground. So who is the empire? Who is the empire? So we started a debate. And ultimately, there was no empire. And Imran Khan claimed that he will come to Islamabad with 1 million people.
Mm-hmm.
But he failed to mobilize even 50,000 people.
Ah.
So there, then the Pakistan Army Chief, Mr. General Rahil Sharif, he was not interested to interfere in politics.
Okay.
So he acted as a professional soldier. He refused to become empire. He refused to raise his finger. Yes, he raised his finger against the religious extremists.
Okay.
And he started a military operation against the religious extremists and fanatics in our tribal areas.
Yeah.
And it was a big surprise for Imran Khan that Army Chief is not interested for interfering in politics. And that's how Nawaz Sharif survived.
Okay.
Now Imran Khan is coming again to Islamabad on 30th of November.
Okay.
And once again, he is claiming that he will overthrow the government of Nawaz Sharif. But I think that the most difficult time for Nawaz Sharif was in August and September.
Huh.
That difficult time is over. Now, some courts have issued arrest warrants of Imran Khan. I think the government of Nawaz Sharif is not interested to arrest him. They will not make him a hero. And the 30th of November will pass very peacefully.
Very peacefully. This is your prediction. Okay. Very interestingly, you have been celebrated, talked about journalists in this region for interviewing Osama bin Laden in 2001. And recently you have started writing a book, biography on Osama bin Laden. And I think you have completed much of your work recently. So Would you please share your experience on writing the biography of Osama bin Laden? And when you expect to see the book will come up in the market?
Zahir bhai, I actually met Osama bin Laden first time in 1997. I interviewed him first time in 1997 when he was a nobody.
Okay.
And I remember that when I published his interview in my newspaper, my chief editor asked me who is this person? Hmm. You have given him so much coverage. I said, he's Osama bin Laden. He said, who is Osama bin Laden?
Okay.
So I did first interview in 97, then the second interview in 98, when I was arrested by Taliban. And after 9/11, I interviewed him third time in November 2001 in Afghanistan.
Oh, okay.
But in my second meeting, which took place in 1998,
that was also in Afghanistan.
That was in Afghanistan. I was asking him very tough questions. And he was responding my questions with the help of many books and references. And one day passed, then the second day passed, then the third day passed. And I said, how will I sum up this big interview in my newspaper columns? So he said, okay, you can write a book.
Okay.
I said, if I will write a book, I will write it objectively.
Okay.
And don't think that...
Without being biased.
That Hamid Mir will only praise you. Oh, I will criticize you. So he said, okay, you are free. So we had an agreement that I will write his biography. But after that meeting, mm-hmm. there were bomb blasts in Kenya and Tanzania.
Okay.
Al-Qaeda never accepted the responsibility, but I was suspecting that they are involved. So I started my investigation about them and I went to Kenya and Tanzania. Then after some time, there was a missile attack in Afghanistan on Osama bin Laden. He survived the US attack. So again, the situation changed. And then after 2001, after 9/11, he became the most wanted person.
Yeah.
And situation again changed. And then it was difficult to meet him. So I was doing my research. And in 2004 and 5, I thought that I may not meet him again.
Mm-hmm.
Because according to my agreement with him, I was bound to show him the final script before publication. Then in 2004, I received a message from him through one cleric that now you are free to
write the book,
to publish the book.
Okay.
But then I was researching and investigating. Now, where is he? Where he is spending his days in hiding? So it took lot of time, and then finally he was killed on 2nd May 2011 in Aptabad. So after his killing, many publishers, they forced me, no, give your script, we want to publish your book,
okay.
You will make a lot of money.
Yeah.
I said, I'm not interested in making money. This is a history.
Yeah.
And I want to know that where and how he was spending the last years of his life in hiding, and what is the actual story of his killing. Some of the US Marines are claiming that they killed him.
Okay.
One Marine, US Marine is saying, I killed Osama bin Laden. The other is saying, no, you never killed him. I killed him.
Huh.
Actually, both are lying. So this last chapter is about to complete. I am trying to meet his wife in Yemen. And then I will publish, hopefully, very soon next year in 2015.
Oh, 2015. Okay, great. We're eagerly waiting to see the book. But just time is running out. We're about to end our program. So let's talk about something on the SARC. You know that the 18th SARC summit is going to be held in November 26th and 27th. There have been a lot of discussions relating to SARC and this potential, its impact, developing relations between the regional countries. So in your view, how do you see the relevance of SARC in the wake of the current tension in the region and the challenges, given challenges being prevailed in the society in the countries of South Asia?
I think SAARC is very important, but unfortunately, the SAARC has failed to become a very effective organization in South Asia. The main reason are the differences between India and Pakistan.
Okay.
And we need to make this forum active and vibrant. And recently, we have included Afghanistan into SAARC. I think that we must include China, Iran, and Myanmar, Burma. China, Iran, and Burma should also become part of the SAARC. And then it will become a big organization, a big platform. And we can convert this South Asia into a South Asia market. And with the help of China and with the help of Iran, we can do a lot of good work in this region. The SAARC summit is coming, and I hope that our leaders of Pakistan, Bangladesh, India, and other SAARC countries will meet them.
Yeah.
But I would like to point out that South Asia is a big region facing multiple problems.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, there is a very big problem in South Asia, not only in Pakistan, but also in India and Bangladesh. And that problem is the rising religious militancy, extremism. It's a big problem. Unfortunately, the SAARC countries lack a joint strategy to fight against terrorism.
Okay.
So I think that in the coming SAARC summit, the leaders of Pakistan, Bangladesh, and India should sit together, and they must form a joint strategy to fight against terrorism. It's very serious. And unfortunately, our leaders are not serious to make a joint strategy. And I hope that the new Prime Minister of India will show some flexibility and he will start talks with Pakistan. And Pakistan, Bangladesh, India, and other SAARC countries, I am repeating, they must adopt a joint strategy to fight against terrorism.
Okay.
Otherwise, the terrorists will prevail.
Okay. Last question is for you, Mr. Hamid Mir, related to journalism. You have been hosting talk show, Capital Talk, and doing. But how free you are in doing pursuing objective journalism in Pakistan right now, very briefly?
I think that Pakistan is becoming one of the most dangerous countries for media in the world. The Pakistani media is facing problems from state actors as well as from non-state actors. We are facing problems not only from Taliban but also from some state actors. Despite all these problems, the free and independent journalists, they are doing a remarkable job. More than 100 journalists lost their lives in last 10 years. If I am speaking freely in my show, it's not because the government of Pakistan has given me this freedom. It's not because the government of Pakistan have provided me some security. It's because I am risking my life. So all those journalists in Pakistan who are speaking truth, they are actually risking their life. So by risking our lives, we are fighting for the right to know, which is the right of our audience, our viewers, our readers. And we think that the free media is essential for strong democracy. And without a free media, a democracy cannot prosper. And I hope that one day will come that media will be totally free in Pakistan.
Thank you so much for your bravery, courage, and conviction.
Thank you, Mr. Zahir.
Thank you so much. Deeply honored and privileged. Thank you so much. Dear viewers, that's all my conversation with veteran journalist from Pakistan, Mr. Hamid Mir. And I hope you have enjoyed our discussion and conversation. And we invite you to watch our next episode. Until then, to take care and bye.